Right, it's 6:45, it's time for us to start basically. It's a very short meeting this evening. I'd like to thank you all for turning up tonight. Before we do start, I'd just like to apologise that I couldn't be in the last meeting, but I'd like to thank Amy Mooney for stepping in and chairing for me on that night. Going straight into the agenda. Straight into the agenda. Is any declarations of interest? Do we have any apologies for absence?
We have one from Councillor Fraser. And Councillor Chris Fraser.
Councillor Solicitor.
Thank you. Agenda item 30, look like one of those ones in place. You want to be smart, isn't it? The Working Committee have made a recommendation. The working committee have just met and we discussed the co-option of our community reps. They recommend that we accept all three community reps. So what I'd like to do now is invite them to take their seats with us, those who are in. Congratulations and then welcome.
Some of the proposals obviously affect council staff and affect jobs
that is subject to statutory trade union consultation, which has been running through the same period, and is also just coming to the end of the process now. Obviously, there's one particular budget proposal, which I'll get to in a second, that requires actually statutory consultation as well, but I'll get to that in a second. Our responses are going up again this year. This is the highest level of consultation feedback we've ever had. The highest level number of consultation responses that we've been able to find anywhere in the country actually for this kind of work. We might just you can see on the screen, just over 10,000 responses, or from just under 8,000 last year. So that's steadily increased over the past few years as people get more involved and more engaged in this budget setting process as developers as it is. Unfortunately, all this time, the difficulty we've had is that an awful lot of the actual additional responses seem to have come from Little West. So that's that chart. It's not the end of the world, but it's not ideal. We'd like that to be an awful lot more even. Everyone's had the opportunity to take part. We've actively promoted it across every constituency in the borough. For one reason or another, this time, we had more from Little West. Little West always more slightly more overrepresented in processes like this. Not usually to that extent. So as I say, it's not the end of the world, but not ideal. If I start taking you through the actual feedback that we've had so far, we had a number of petitions. These numbers were correct at the time of producing the capital report. They've actually a little bit higher now. Obviously, we had a petition online relating to the Get Your Call proposal, which I'll get to in a second. As well as that, there was also a bit of a social media campaign in terms of a Save Get Your Call Facebook page, which had 500 and something likes as well. The Get Your Call petition is now up to 307 signatures. Stop the Job Cuts, Stop the Service Cuts petition was a unison petition. That's now up to 21 signatures. And there was a specific petition to be linked to this constituency around the School Crossing Patrol at Christchurch School, which I believe is in Mooney. So that had 280 signatures.
Can I ask questions at the end?
So, first of all, what I was going to take you through is the policy questionnaire that I was talking about. So the first question we asked in that more generic questionnaire was about whether the council should look to provide shared services, joining up with neighbours across Merseyside and across places like Cheshire to provide joint services to try and economies of scale and save money that way. As you'll see, I'm going to whiz through these if it's okay, because I'm sure you're more interested in the proposals themselves. As you'll see, you can't be that's really strong support in that proposal as you would imagine it should be. Slightly different when we talk about whether we should increase charges or implement charges for services that are chargeable. Quite a lot of the services we provide and charge for, we don't charge enough to even cover the costs, much less make them actually a commercial operation. Sometimes we don't charge for things that we could. We ask the question around that. Not outright opposition, but certainly a more mixed view. About slightly more people that would support the proposal, but you certainly wouldn't categorise that people even overly supportive of that proposal. Again, alternative delivery was really when we were looking at the detailed question was whether the council should look into whether the private sector, the community or voluntary organisation could provide a cheaper, more efficient service for some current council functions and ask people whether they supported it. Again, people generally didn't see much of an issue with that, I don't think. Again, similar question, but whether the council should actually remain responsible for delivering everything it should deliver now, whether it should look to commission more. We're going to be commissioning quite a bit now in terms of waste collection and all of our highways work. It's already commissioned. Again, people are generally comfortable with that as an idea. And the final question we asked in this questionnaire was about assets. As you know, the council owns hundreds of buildings for a variety of different things, from the direct delivery of services through to council office buildings, and should we start rationalising that? Should we work out a smaller number of buildings and try and save money that way? Again, people don't seem to see any kind of problem with that at all. So, the specific proposals. I'm going to take you through one slide per proposal, and as I said, there's only nine, so I'll shut up soon. What I've tried to do against each one of the proposals, and you'll see in the cabinet report as well, is summarise what comments we've actually received from members of the public, from residents. The actual verbatim comments, every single comment that we've actually received is actually online at the moment, so members are more than welcome to come and review all the comments as well. Where appropriate as well, maybe what I've tried to reference, where we've had specific representations or specific letters garden waste charging. You see quite a lot of comments against that, 202 comments. Generally, people with that concern, an awful lot of the comments that you've been through, they're saying that the service has been going through years, it hasn't been, we haven't had a price increase, we're looking at taking it from £35 a year to £40 a year, unless you're paying online, we're going to go from 30 to 35. I think that's it. That brings in around all 200,000 income. Wasn't going to be in a opposition to that, generally. The only concerns we had raised were whether it would lead to an increase in flight tipping and a decrease in recycling rates, that kind of thing. But I think that's from our standpoint, I would imagine we could just get to communications campaign, then, which we're already running at the moment. So, clearly, this is the reprovision of commercial courts, the most difficult, certainly the most sensitive and emotive proposal that's out there at the moment. First thing to say, and probably the most important thing to say, is that this isn't the entirety of the consultation in terms of commercial court. Commercial court is subject to legal statutory consultation, which is around one-to-one discussion with each individual family that needs the service, or could use the service in the future, about how they actually, how their care could be provided in a different way. This is what I've presented to you tonight, is the comments, the feedback we've had from the public. So there's an exercise going on currently at the moment, the statutory consultation process. That's a 3-month process that will continue until, I think, about the middle of March. So this is just ongoing feedback. Really. As I say, 189 comments. Generally, obviously this is a really emotive issue. The comments we've had, I've tried to summarise into two broad themes, which is, I think, is about reasonable. It's about the alternative provision, whether it's there, the quality of it. They're generally concerned about whether that it's an anxiety about whether that care is actually available, which is being addressed through the one-to-one discussions with the people in adult social care, but that's generally the feedback we've got. And also people were just there was some anxiety about relationships with staff and people are generally comfortable in that place. So that's generally the feedback. I know that there's mitigation against everything. That's generally the feedback we've had on that proposal. I can come back to any of these at the end of the future to answer any more questions. Self-assessment. What that proposal was where people were able to self-assess and to self-assess their own needs for social care. We would put the process in place to allow them to, either through online or through paper forms or anything like that. The only people that would actually get support to be sent to give an assessment were the people actually needed the support. Again, not a huge amount of opposition to that proposal. We've got three people who are relatively comfortable with that. Similarly, with community safety, this doesn't represent any kind of real service reduction. What we're looking at in this proposal was community safety is often a paid-for service from landlords, from schools, from various private enterprises across the world. It should be more. It should be more commercial work and start generating and be more of a commercial operation. The other element of this particular saving was the current dog fouling operation we've got going in the council to move that into the same kind of model as we've got going for litter enforcement. So we do a similar kind of contract. Again, people were relatively comfortable with the entire proposal, and I'm actually particularly in agreement to dog fouling and leasing laws, they're taking that kind of hard line approach. The only real bit of feedback we got was that people didn't want to see a reduction in the quality of the service, which I don't think this would do. Leisure centres and golf. Before we started, thought this was going to be an awful lot more controversial and emotive than it was. But this was around putting our leisure centres on a much more commercial footing. At the moment, leisure centres are running at a combined loss of about £4.5 million a year. We're giving away an awful lot of product for free, which are good decisions originally, but if you want to try and make these places more commercial, more sustainable longer term, we took the view that we maybe should review that. So this would remove things like free swimming, it would remove like free access for certain groups. It would also look at transfer to community ownership of each of the leisure centres as well. for the libraries, we try and find community ownership for 12 of them. That wouldn't result in the closure of any sites at all. But we go out, we go and try and find volunteers, community organisations to actually get involved in what they're asking in their work and delivery. We had generally three different types of feedback there. Whether the library, whether the service would remain really reliable if it had too many volunteers in there. People were generally okay and it resulted in no closures. Some people were actually saying you've got too many libraries. Not a huge amount of people saying that, but quite a few did. A number of residents were talking about the potential loss of quality of the service if librarians were leaving and not being replaced. We also had a really detailed piece of feedback from the Friends of the Library Steel Group, Professor Lou, who's responsible for training along those same lines, really. We're looking at it maybe in a different way. Parks was a similar proposal in that we could mitigate and reduce our cost if we were allowing more community organisations, more friends groups to take more of an active role in actually running on people at parks. People were really proud of parks when they voted in. It seemed to be a really great source of pride to people. People were generally supportive of it. There was, similar to the library, some people said how reliable would it be and that type of comment, but again, not outright opposition to this proposal. People were also talking about different ideas for what events in parks and different ways of generating to actually keep them more sustainable and protect the services really and the parks themselves. This is the last proposal that we publicly closed on. Now this is an element of pest control, I think it's rats and rat infestations, which at the moment we provide for free. We proposed to put in a small charge for this. We got quite a few people saying that this kind of thing disproportionately affects those neighbourhoods and those households that actually can't afford to pay for it in the first place. So there was some concerns about that. Some people did agree and said the private sector did it, you either don't do it or you charge for it. But quite a lot of people were saying that, no, this is, if someone's got a rat infestation and you can't afford to pay, you need to go fix it for them. Generally, was the feedback from residents. Highways and road safety was three specific things. The first one was roadside rip-ins. Now we've got 298 meters of water with 200 of them are on specific written routes, which are on the main routes for the wagons, and it's just naturally that people stop and we can fill them up. 198 of them were put in with Area 4 only a few years ago, and they are basically dotted around whatever residents felt were most appropriate, which are on the routes to take forever to fill. The proposal is we wouldn't fill them with those ones anymore. Community groups, constituency committees, if they so wish, could allocate funding to it to actually pick up that slack. The other element of it was some revenue from the preventative maintenance. An awful lot of council, most councils actually, from all highways work out of specific grants for that process. Our council still tops up that money with some revenue funding as well to do preventative highway maintenance. This would reduce that budget quite a bit. I think it might move it actually in terms of the actual revenue funding part of it. So all the maintenance we would do on the highways would be directly grant funded work. Finally, the school cost controls, whereby out of the, I think, 100 sites we've got, 41 or 42 of them are actually on sites where there's already either a Peloton crossing or some kind of electronic green man type crossing in place as well. Subject to a detailed risk assessment with the police, we remove that school cross control from that site. That's an element of that. In terms of this, obviously, which actually is the last one thing, DHP is discretionary housing payments, which is we get a grant from government which is in the region of 700,000 to pay out discretionary housing payments to people who are in hardship. What happens is that we generally top out with an additional about 300,000 because the initial projection was that the government grant wasn't going to be enough. This would limit our discretionary housing payments to the government grant in that proposal. The other part of the proposal was around the council's internal welfare rights unit, which provides advice and guidance to people in quite specialist and specific areas of welfare benefits, particularly about appeals and tribunals and that kind of thing. In terms of the all the proposals. We've got to set a budget during the beginning of March this year on council tax levels. Tomorrow night, as well as all the public consultation feedback, there's been, you all have been involved in a really detailed and comprehensive scrutiny process as well. So all of this consultation feedback from the public and all of the three scrutiny reports have all been taken to cabinet and they go on the next Monday. I'll be doing the same presentation to coordinate committee tomorrow night. Next Monday, cabinet will propose the budget. That budget will be recommended to budget council the following week, the first week of March. Jeff.
Thanks very much, Kevin. And I expect a number of people indicating that questions will go straight to the office.
Thanks, Chairman. And thanks, Kevin, for the presentation. A couple of questions, or a couple of points, maybe, of questions. You talked about the online petitions.
Yeah.
And take the actual petition is one that I'm keenly interested in. At 307 signatures. There's also a written petition of over 2,000 signatures. Where does that feature in the consultation? Same with school crossing patrols, I know with the Crochet School, not in early my ward, submitted a petition of, I think it's 493 signatures, yet that doesn't show on there. How do they fit in to this consultation process?
Okay, if I go back, the Crochet School was on there, but I think I put the wrong number down against it. Okay. But I've had that one myself. I've copied and pasted and left the wrong number in there, so I apologise. Okay. So we've got that, so that's been reported in. In terms of the paper petition for Gage Report, I haven't actually been given.
Well, that came on by Unison, so.
Okay, so that's
been submitted. They might not have submitted.
Okay, so that's, if that hasn't been submitted as yet, as soon as it's submitted, it'll have to be submitted before council. So it hasn't been submitted as yet. So everything I've received has been
submitted. If we can just try and show. You talked about the, and again, I'm going back to the case, of course, 189 comments. You said that all these comments, the data were online, they're accessible.
I'll send you
a link tonight. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And that's for all the consultations, all the nine elements.
All the comments are online for each of the individual proposals. The point to remember with the actual clause is it won't include the one-to-one statutory consultation. It's a different thing. It's the public consultation.
Well, just 189 ones. That's fine. On the actual clause, just pushing the issue. When you talked about the introduction of that £5 charge. Your slide said most people were supportive of it. Of that 189 comments on the actual course, I'm assuming, might be wrong, that most of those were opposed to it.
Yeah, quite.
But
yeah.
You didn't say that in your presentation on the actual course, but generally people were opposed to the closure of the actual course. You just listed their concerns. There's only reason why you didn't use the opposed to it.
Well, because I think that was almost implicit in terms of that these were the concerns, because I didn't really have any concerns to list against Garden Waste. I've said there were generally people that were supportive of it. Where Gage Report clearly that wasn't the case, I've just listed the concerns.
Just being presented.
Yeah.
Right, I've got Annette, and Treena, and Janette. Anita, sorry.
Thanks, Chair. I just really wanted to mention about the Gage Report. I was really quite concerned at the last constituency meeting that a number of people were saying that for the age group 30 to 50 that there was no places for them to go. As soon as I came back from that meeting, I emailed Phil Davis, the leader of the council, to say I had that concern. And since then, I've actually been told by Graham Hodgkinson about the one-to-one interview process. And it would appear that the 30 to 50 year olds to services, but I just feel a little bit more comfortable with the fact that there will be a one-to-one interview and a provision provided that's suitable to each of the people interviewed.
Treena?
Yeah, I agree totally with Councillor Leech on that. I do feel that there was a confusion over the list that were given to those that were affected by these devastating cuts and the situation that we're in now, so I agree with that. I would just like some clarification on you're saying that the petitions that are in, the date's not yet up there, is it? I mean, we've still got a deadline to meet, is that right? Is that 3rd of March? Or?
Well, the budget council is 3rd of March. We had a public consultation between the 7th, the 18th to the January the 25th. In terms of the petitions, people are...
they can still submit them, but there is a deadline.
Well, for them to be considered as part of the budget set process, yeah. Then Colin, 5 days before council.
Yeah,
5 days before council. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, you got Janette then, Ron.
Thank you,
Chair. I was a bit disappointed to note that the participation for Wallasey was the lowest, and was it less than half of that of Will West? Mm-hmm. And I think that mirrors the dissatisfaction we saw in the episode Laing results that were presented to us, I think it was 2 weeks ago now. That Wallasey constituency has the least satisfaction with the council, although rates are still relatively good across the borough. I can't force people to participate, but what I'd be disappointed to see is a cycle of more middle class people who are used to articulating their interests and getting those, the ear of people to say what their interests are, and then that becomes a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy, because then as we can see, we're all masters compared to Wallasey, and therefore you wonder, do they have undue influence over decisions that are made, and then it becomes a middle class sort of litany of what. Well, I'm just concerned that, and I suspect that's probably why there wasn't that many many responses around welfare budgeting, because I imagine that the participants that we've got in front of us may not have ever had to use welfare budgeting. But that doesn't mean to say it's not an integral part of the council. So as long as we take that in mind, we might say, well, that welfare rights wasn't actually really much an issue with our constituents. Yeah. But when you look at the breakdown of who's responded, perhaps there's an answer there.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that, Bob.
Yeah. One of my two colleagues have made a comment, I think, on Girls' Court. It's difficult to make definitive comments around Girls' Court when it's still out for consultation. And until that consultation is in fact, I think is an overview and a more rounded view. I think trying to make comments around meeting consultation is preempting things. I think I'd rather wait to see what the consultation tells me before I come out and say what I would support and what I wouldn't support. We're at that stage. It's very critical. People need to be able to consult, not against the background of being pressurised or bullied or whatever form is taken, that they can take and make clear decisions themselves, which is in the benefit of their family and their welfare and the welfare of their dependents. I would urge people to wait before we make definitive comments or just definitive decisions on the outcome of the consultation.
Jenny?
It's just a quick question. On one of your feedbacks you said about service delivery and it was either going to the private sector or the voluntary sector, there is a stark difference between those sectors, and we kind of noted that in ours, because some people would want a private sector organisation to obviously get a contract, whereas voluntary community sector organisation is very different. And also, it said about Beechwood Leisure Centre being put up. Is that the only leisure centre being looked at to go up to terms up with anyone else?
The first point about the voluntary sector and the private sector, they're absolutely fair point. This is one of those things that questions really broadly that we're overlooking with them, but 100% of fair point. In terms of the legislators, as far as I'm aware, the only one that's active discussion for taking place is Beechwood at the moment. Not to say that there's something might happen in the future, but at the moment that's the conversation. I think with the development trust or something, Beechwood Development Trust.
Okay.
consultation. I met with some of the carers last week, and they've started the process. Some of these people started the process, and some have had two or three meetings so far and achieved nothing. So until they actually get something that's suitable, you know, but they are something, obviously, you know, and to say that we need to see the end of the consultation before we make any decisions, this is all part of that consultation. This is the crux of it. The whole matter is to do with those people that need that care. And you know, what we are happy about is that it's Graham Hodgson's now extended the respite of the actual cause, given us to the end of June, which gives us a little bit more breathing space. But it's all about the quality of care for these people. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. I wasn't going to get into that discussion because this isn't the place of discussing the wise way of water, here's of course, other than to say I agree entirely with what Abby said, and that we should have a consultation, of course, before decisions are made. The problem we've got with that, Chairman, is that Cabinet meets on the 22nd of February to make this decision. Council meets on the 3rd of March to make this decision. The one-to-one consultations will not be finished. So unfortunately, Council Abby, decisions will be made before consultation ends because of the timetable this council is operating to. So that is a problem. That is a problem that you guys can solve by telling your side to fall back on Pearson Court until all the consultation is complete. Thank you.
Okay, does someone else indicate? So Ken, thank you very much for the excellent presentation. Thanks for joining us. Right, we've got no other items on the agenda, it's none of the business, but tears and bones for all this year. When we meet again on the 14th of April, what tends to happen if last year's anything to go by is we have community groups come up and they tell us how they spent the money and the great work that they've done, and those who were here last year, I'm sure you agree. It was a wonderful thing, it's very nice to see the work that's been done. I would like to suggest that this year, when you come and do that again, that we give them a little certificate thanking them for the work